Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 12935 in the name of Martin Whitfield on Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons. And I invite Martin Whitfield to open the debate around about 7 minutes. Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I would like to thank those members across this chamber and indeed across the Parliament who made this member's debate motion possible, because it talks about Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity. And Scotland's children and young people are facing unprecedented mental health, well-being, resilience crisis. And this is self-evidently a challenge for those children and young people, but also their families. But it is also a problem for all of us. It is a problem for Scotland, because they are the future of Scotland. They are our future society, the future economy. And Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity, ECHC, have been keen to work closely with politicians and policymakers to tackle this growing problem. And last year, the Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity commissioned research which found that, sadly, nearly 6 in 10 families in Scotland have a child who they believe has experienced a mental health concern at some point in their life. Children and young people who face mental health challenges like anxiety, low mood, issues related to school. An early intervention is vital in addressing those concerns, helping both the child and their family to not only overcome but to thrive. However, we are aware of the significant pressure that sits on CAMHS, which must focus on the most severe cases first. And it often means that children with less critical issues are left without support and are left without that support for extended periods. This delay leads only to a worsening of their mental health, causing problems that could have been prevented with timely intervention. And the Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity declared that there was no time to wait. And as a charity, they secured funding to launch their own pilot wellbeing and resilience service, which has now been fully operational for almost 12 months. And this service has been transformational for the young people and their family members who have been able to access mental health support without the need for lengthy waiting lists and without the need of tight criteria. No time to wait is the Pilot Wellbeing and Resilience Service, designed to complement CAMHS to help prevent problems escalating to the point where psychiatric intervention is needed. And the Haven Wellbeing and Resilience Service, No Time to Wait's pilot site, opened last September at the Fraser Centre in Trenent, East Lothian. And data collected over the first year of its operation is showing tangible results which give the charity hope that Scotland's paediatric mental health crisis is reversible. In this short time that the service has been up and running, it has played its own part, albeit in a small way compared to the whole of Scotland, but it has played a small part in alleviating the pressure on CAMHS, helping children and young people with their well-being. The majority of the...
I wonder if my friend might give way.
More than...
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to my friend Martin Whitfield for giving way, in part so I can express my thanks to the Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity as a parent of a child who spent some time in the sick kids as it was. I know the work they do, because when a child goes into hospital, the whole family is put under immense pressure. So therefore, it comes as no surprise that they're supporting people and young people in this holistic way, because it is what they always do. And I think the point the member just raises about that, looking at that well-being in those difficult circumstances in that holistic way, goes to the very heart of what they are as an organisation and what they do. I wonder if you might agree with that point.
Martin Whitfield, then give you the time back.
I'm very grateful for that intervention. And Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity, from its inception, has always taken a holistic approach, be it in those first instances from just providing pyjamas for children who came in who had nothing, to the cups of tea, to the rooms that allowed parents just a break from all of it, to have a shower and a few minutes to grasp. And it sits at the heart of why Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity is so important. But it also sits at the heart in that it is what we would want for every child who comes into contact with any health services. And it is right that this is almost a unique instance where they have stepped out of the hospital environment to work with children in an environment at the Fraser Centre where they themselves, the children, feel comfortable, feel safe. It's an environment they know and understand. And the charity fully understand, with no time to wait, that you require that confidence. You require children to be able to build connections. And they do that best where they feel safe. Because the majority of the attendees have mental health concerns around feelings of anxiety, low mood, and the issues at school, even attendance at school. And these reversible feelings can be helped if founded and handled early enough. Around one third of those who've attended The Haven have struggled with school attendance. One third have reported self-harm. But the early data shows that the children and young people who attend The Haven are themselves reporting improvements. Over 80% report that their self-harm has reduced. These are small successes, but to a child who has found it difficult to have their voice listened to, for a child who is concerned that they're bringing pressure on their family because of the way that they're feeling and choose to use that pressure in a self-monitory way, just to have that break, to start to see that improvement is enormous. Others report improved communication skills, just feeling better, feeling more positive, becoming involved in community projects and improved self-confidence, the absolute route we would want for every young person. When I visited, I had the pleasure of meeting a young person who was brilliantly articulate, asked incredibly difficult and challenging questions, but also shared the fact that she was looking forward to taking her singing ability to a festival during the Edinburgh festivals in East Lothian, where I know she performed brilliantly. So, the Scottish Government does have some of the broadest powers available in any devolved government, and I absolutely welcomed in the programme for government the First Minister speaking about local solutions to national problems, and that one solution doesn't necessarily need to fit all scenarios. But what I can say, with honesty and with passion, that having had the opportunity to see The Haven, to see the people who are working there, the skill, the passion, the ability, the empathy of the Haven team is a solution. And I put the question to the Scottish Government, will you take it? Because there is no time to waste.
Thank you very much. We now move to the open debate. I call first Ben McPherson to be followed by Craig Hoy. Around 4 minutes, Mr McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And first of all, I pay tribute to Martin Whitfield, who, and as he would say, it's a pleasure to follow. And I commend him for bringing this motion to the Parliament to raise awareness and pay tribute to the Edinburgh Children's Hospital charity, and also for his ongoing work on issues of children's rights and children's well-being as a parliamentarian. As Martin Whitfield has set out, the ECHC, as it's abbreviated to, offers additional support to seriously ill babies, children and young people, along with their families, and when they are facing a hospital experience. The charity also offers a range of services designed to improve the hospital experiences of children and young people, and by providing wellbeing support, facilitating arts and activities, helping to make improvements to hospital spaces, and distributing grants to NHS teams to fund initiatives designed to enhance children's care. Clearly an important charity for the whole of Edinburgh and the Lothians, and as an Edinburgh MSP, I would also want to put my thanks on the record for all the work that they do and pay tribute to them as an organisation. Moving to some of what the motion also focuses on, which is of course the initiative of The Haven, and it reminds me of an organisation in my constituency called The Junction, which I have spoken about in this Parliament a number of times. And these third sector organisations, these third sector initiatives and projects that facilitate mental health support to either provide early intervention before the need for CAMHS, or to relieve some of the workload and demand on the CAMHS service, I think really make an important difference. And to raise awareness of whether it's the Haven in East Lothian or the Junction in Leith, or I'm sure other members here today and across the chamber would be able to point to local organisations in their communities. These local charities that have the local networks, the local connections, the local understanding and are accessible in the community really do make a difference, along with some of the bigger charities. But I think today is an excellent debate because it focuses on those local charities, and particularly, of course, the Haven as part of ECHC. The wider point in the motion about needing to support our young people because they are tomorrow's population in terms of servants, workers, carers, parents, you name it, I don't think can be overstated. And actually, one of the things that crosses my mind often in my constituency work and more widely is just how much younger generations are having to cope with comparatively at even the way it was at the turn of the century. Now, of course, history has seen harder times past, but actually, whether it's internally, domestically, that young people have had an austerity crisis attached to a financial crisis, and then arguably a Brexit crisis, followed by a pandemic, and if you apply also external concerns about war and peace and climate breakdown, what young people are having to deal with in their day-to-day considerations, as well as, you know, what's happening in their communities, is a lot. So, if I may, Presiding Officer.
Very short. Briefly, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the member taking intervention. And would he agree with me that actually, I think, particularly for young people rather than children, they see an expectation on them to help those around them, including their families, that perhaps previous generations of young people didn't have, and actually it is adding to some of the stress and absorbing of the stress that exists already within those families?
Ben McPherson.
I do think that's part of it. And, of course, the challenge on us as parliamentarians with the powers that we have in this institution is how do we relieve some of that demand and pressure and anxiety and expectation that comes with it. And I think devolution in its 25th year has helped, and I'm sure the Minister will touch on the additional support in schools that there is, the social security support that's available, as well as increased funding for mental health services and a reducing of the stigma around going for help with mental ill health. So we've made plenty of progress, but is there much to do? Absolutely, and for our young people, we should all focus on doing it.
Thank you. I now call Craig Hoy to be followed by Callum Mochan in around 4 minutes. Mr Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Martin Whitfield for bringing forward this important members' debate, and like Ben McPherson, it is a pleasure to follow on from them. Like Mr Whitfield, I've had the pleasure of meeting the team from Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity on two occasions, first here in the garden lobby of the Parliament, and this week at the Haven. And when visiting the team at the Haven in their home at the Fraser Centre, Fiona Sullivan illustrated to me firsthand how committed the staff are to delivering innovative early intervention and family-focused services for young people who, as Mr Whitfield said, are struggling with their mental health, often with anxiety, but including depression and also self-harm. And since COVID, there has been a much greater focus on children and young people's mental health and on the pressures faced by the CAMHS system. Now, Minister, much of that coverage has been negative in its nature, about how the system is stretched, about long waits and about rejected referrals. And these are problems which should, can and hopefully will be addressed by ministers through time. But solving these problems will, I suspect, never address the needs of every young person, which is why we need services like the Haven. Now, the Haven doesn't work in isolation. Where it needs to, and it frequently does, it integrates seamlessly with the CAM system. It uses the same language and the same techniques, creating a continuum of care that ensures that children and young people receive the support that they need. But we must remember, and I think this is something that I was acutely aware of visiting this week, that the Haven is a pilot, and while early stage evaluation underlines its positive impact, its future is not a given, even in the micro climate that it's occupying in one town in one part of Scotland. And at the moment, Edinburgh Children's Hospital Charity is entirely funding the facility, but in the long term, it will need Scottish Government funding to make it sustainable and to make it scalable across the country. As Mr Whitfield's motion makes clear, since it opened, there have been 1,264 visits to the Haven, of which 274 were unique visitors who were directly supported by the service. So if we think cumulatively, 274 individuals in a single town, just imagine what impact it could have if it had reach across the whole of Scotland. And as the motion also makes clear, without places like the Haven, there is a risk that the mental health problems of children, of Scotland's children today become the mental health problems of the adults of tomorrow. And I think there is also a risk that the absence of alternative pathways and without early intervention, too many children and young people will end up reaching levels of acuity where they require inpatient CAM services and which are in Lothian, are in very short supply. And having visited the Haven and spoken to the team, I know how committed they are to that principle of early intervention and non-time sensitive care. And the service is also open to the young people themselves, which is very important, but it's also open to their families. And certainly talking to constituents of mine and friends and family who have experienced their own children going through the service, they often feel locked out of that process, the process of treatment, the process of counselling, and also the process of recovery. And obviously with CAMHS, the young people go through a service which is generally has a deadline for each stage of the process, whereas the facility at the Haven doesn't have that. It allows each child to go at their own pace. And I think one of the other things that came out of the discussion I had with them recently was that the families do not need to keep telling their story time and time again, which is something that is traumatic. I got the impression that they are literally seeking to get it right for every child. Now, I know Mr Whitfield has visited the Haven, and I would encourage the Minister and others to visit the Haven. I know they're very, very keen to invite politicians and other stakeholders, because it's only through that collaboration will they be able to get this pilot on a long-term and sure footing. And I would also encourage senior representatives of East Lothian Council, the Chief Executive, the Head of Education, and other senior officers to engage and visit, because only through that council collaboration will they be able to drive change on the ground. I'd just like to close briefly, not with my own words, but with those of the Haven, because I believe this sums up what they offer and what they could hopefully offer right throughout Scotland if we manage to find a sustainable financial footing upon which to put them. It says, we offer support in a fully accessible, relaxed and informal setting. We do this through a range of activities we know young people will enjoy. Or if all you need is a cup of tea and a listening ear, we're here to help you cope. Our team is there on the good days, the bad days, and everything else in between. That's the kind of service we need to see at the heart of our communities, and hopefully the government, the local authorities and the third sector can work together to deliver projects like the Haven right throughout Scotland.
Thank you very much. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Carol Moch, in around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank my colleague, Martin Whitfield, for bringing this debate to the Chamber, as others have said. And I am not surprised to see it here today under Martin's name, as I think we can all agree this issue and that of the rights of children and young people are always a priority for my friend on these benches. The member has spoken to me before about the excellent work of the No Time to Wait campaign, as we've heard, launched a pilot wellbeing and resilience service, The Haven, in September 2023 in Tranent. And it's super to hear that others have been along, and I think the Minister has been as well. So, and I know from the discussions that I've had with Martin from his visit that he did just meet the most amazing young people, as we do have in all our communities. Not just the young people, it's their families as well that have benefited from this scheme. And from Martin Whitfield's experience, the staff have also really benefited from this kind of service. And they are, as many of our staff out there in our communities do, going way above and beyond that call to make sure that we can help our young people, ensure that we don't have young people unnecessarily going into mental health crisis. As we know, it is designed to work and complement our CAM service, and I think that's an important point, is that the more that our local services can join up with our public services, the better our outcomes are going to be. But to be able to provide something that means that a young person might not have to go into that more psychiatric or more clinical environment, I think is just a super intervention. And I know that my colleague Ben McPherson mentioned that there are other services there doing that. So we're so lucky to have those services, and we need to make sure that we work together to get that right. Because we all in this place talk about that preventable approach. And so I think from the speeches that we've heard today, but in other parts of the Chamber and in our committees, we do really all right across the Chamber believe in that approach. So this is why it's really important that these members' debates are taken to here. And I think, for me, I think the important point is that we want young people and their families to know that you don't need to go into crisis, that there are other things out there in that informal local space where young people and families can talk about their struggles and what they might do and what might help them. We've heard that it has been successful. You know, it's not that we're just talking about it. We know from their 6 months report that 52% of those who had visited felt that their situation had improved. So that's that lived experience that we talk about so much right across this Scottish Parliament. I was fortunate enough to visit the Edinburgh Children's Hospital charity last year, which it's linked to, and you could tell from going there the work that they do is just tremendous. And if you go on the website, the first little thing that comes up is you see, if you donate to the charity, it says, will you give more than medicine to children? And I think that shows what it is that they're seeking to do. And on my visit, the staff showed me that the great facility on that site, which I know is mirrored in the Haven site, is about that understanding, that relationship, that sense of play and normal space and family time. And it was very, very impressive. So the staff team are dedicated. We know that young people are getting an advantage from that being that local community. So, Presiding Officer, to close, I think we can all agree in the chamber that we recognise these local community-based projects really are things that we should get behind. And I hope the Minister, I know the Minister will, in her closing remarks, make reference to that, and that she'll give us a sense of how we can all work together, because I think sometimes the members' debates allow us to have those kind of conversations about how we can all work together. So can I just close by thanking all the speakers in the debate and hope that our constituents can get the benefit of these services right across Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochan. I now invite Marie Todd to wind up the debate around 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking members for their contributions today and extending my congratulations to Edinburgh's Children's Hospital charity. The Scottish Government recognises the importance of third sector organisations like Edinburgh Children's Hospital charity in supporting work to improve mental health and wellbeing. I was really delighted to be able to visit their hub at the Royal Hospital for Children and Young People in Edinburgh last year and see the incredible work they're doing to support children and their families. And I know the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care was also able to visit the Haven services recently, and I know he found that visit inspiring. Our vision is to make Scotland the best place in the world to grow up, a place where everyone's rights are respected and where children and young people can access the right support at the right time from the right people so that they grow up feeling loved, safe and respected. It's very clear that supporting good mental health and wellbeing is absolutely critical in this vision. That's not to say it's straightforward, and like other members, I want to acknowledge the many challenges that our children and young people face, the added pressure that growing up through the pandemic and in a cost of living crisis presents. The Joint Mental Health and Wellbeing Strategy, which we published with COSLA last year, rightly takes a whole system approach, recognising that improving mental health and wellbeing must be a cross-government priority. It recognises the need to place greater emphasis on early intervention and prevention to improve access and quality of mental health services and to increase community-based support and services, as well as support growth and alignment of the mental health workforce. These priorities are echoed in our funding. So over the past 4 years, the Scottish Government's provided significant investment in supports and services for children and young people's mental health and wellbeing. That includes an annual investment of £16 million to support the provision of counselling services in secondary schools, which are available to all children in Scotland who are aged 10 years and over. Since 2020, we've also provided local authorities with over £50 million to develop and deliver new and enhanced community-based mental health supports and services for children and young people and their families, and a further £15 million is available this year. These supports and services are focused on prevention and early intervention, promoting positive mental health and wellbeing, and tackling emotional distress. Where appropriate, the services do offer an alternative to CAMHS by providing support in a community setting. And supports and services are available in every local authority area. In the first half of 2023 alone, they were accessed by over 58,000 children, young people and their families. And last year I had the privilege of visiting one of these services back on track in Edinburgh, and speaking to some of those receiving support, it was clear just how vital this intervention is for children, young people and their families. Now, our Community Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund for Adults also supports a range of community-led projects for those aged 16 years and older, with grassroots projects benefiting from £66 million in funding since 2021. And seeking to go further upstream, we've also provided funding to a range of children and young people's organisations to create a suite of online resources, information and advice that supports the emotional health and wellbeing of children and young people. That includes work that's been undertaken by Young Scot to build and promote the I Feel online hub. We've also funded the Scottish Youth Parliament's Mind Your Time resource, designed by children and young people to support healthy use of social media and screens. And we've also worked with Parent Club to provide a range of advice for parents and carers on supporting the mental health and wellbeing of their children and young people, most recently with new resources available for the parents of teenage children. We're also seeing sustained progress in other key areas to supporting children and young people's mental health. Now, in the first half of this year, we've seen the best national performance against CAMHS waiting time since the 18-week standard was introduced 10 years ago. One in two children and young people who are referred to CAMHS now start treatment within 6 weeks, and CAMHS staffing has increased by more than 63% in the last decade. Now, despite the progress we've made, we are very far from complacent. We are clear that long waits are unacceptable, and we remain committed to supporting all boards to meet the expected standards. Likewise, we're committed to further enhancing support for children and young people at the earliest opportunity. That's why early intervention and prevention is one of the four key priorities agreed by the new Joint Strategic Board for Children and Family Mental Health with COSLA and other partners. We'll continue to pursue that, along with other priorities of improving support for children and young people in crisis, caring for those in vulnerable situations, and continuing to enhance perinatal and infant mental health. Yep. Sorry.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Minister giving way on that point, and I think it's right that it should be registered that so much of this support, and particularly with the Haven, may not prevent young people needing to see CAMHS. However, they will present to CAMHS in a better position than they would have been without the support while this waiting list is, while they've been working their way through that waiting list.
Minister.
So I'm absolutely keen to see the outcome of the study that's going on. When I met with the charity, I was hugely impressed by the work that they're doing, which is holistic in its nature and helps children to access timely support and may enable them in some cases to wait well while they wait for the NHS intervention that they undoubtedly need. So I'm really keen to hear more about that. One word and note of caution, though, is we all agree that local developments are usually the best. They can recognise the assets that are available in communities, the care and support available in your part of the country, in the members' part of the country, in Edinburgh and the Lothians. It's very different from what's available in mine in the rural West Highlands. And it's not so easy to pick up the learning from these one projects and spread them everywhere. However, I do think, as a government, we need to be better and cleverer at learning and scaling when things work. In closing, I want to restate my thanks and congratulations to all of the staff from the Edinburgh Children's Hospital charity for their unwavering commitment to supporting children and young people and families in the Edinburgh and Lothians area. I'm very grateful to them and to all of our third sector organisations who work tirelessly for the care and support and well-being of our children and young people. They play an absolutely vital role in supporting us to achieve our strategic vision of a Scotland free from stigma and inequality, where everyone fulfils their right to achieve the best mental health and well-being possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.